Pistons and Celtics called by the Kevins. Harlan and McHale with Kristen Ledlow working the sidelines. And then the Grizz and the Suns with Brian Anderson, Brent Berry, Reggie Miller, and Jamie Maggio. Here in Atlanta, TNT NBA tip-off is presented by Auto Trader, Ernie Johnson, Charles Barkley, Kenny the Jet Smith, Shaquille O'Neal. Celtics, Pistons. We're going to start with Detroit. I've got a stat, and our guys researched this, and this is pretty amazing to me. In their first 27 games, these guys were allowing just under 96 points a game, and over the last 20, 14 points worse. Mm. Shaq, how does that happen? How does a team go from allowing 96 to 110 in the span of 20 games?
Well, it's surprising. I'm going to use the word lack of focus, but I play for Stan Van Gundy. He's a guy that will definitely get you prepared for the game with stats, with films, with the things that he says. And, you know, this one is just, you know, I have to put this onus on the players. You know, they just have to step up and you know, do a little bit better. Because if you look at that roster, they're pretty talented. You know, we thought that they were going to do a whole lot better. Right now, they're just not responding. But can't blame it on Stan Van Gundy, because I played with him and Pat Riley, and they definitely have you prepare for every game.
Whose team is this in Detroit?
Well, it's...
I'm not a guy...
You
look at the Celtics, that's Isaiah Thomas's team.
Yeah, you know, I'm not a guy who kind of does that. Everyone has roles. Isaiah Thomas's role is to score. You know, if you say whose team is it to defend, you, Isaiah Thomas's name wouldn't come up. So everybody has their role, and everybody has different roles, and some guys are scoring. Get the name of their team. But I just think if you look at Detroit as well, it usually that comes down to lack of trust. Because the same way you trust guys on offense, you trust them on defense. So, like, if I'm told my assignment is to send a guy baseline, and I say Shaq's going to be there to cut him off baseline, and he's not there, then the next time I go, well, I'm going to play him a little straight up. Then Shaq comes over. And now he beats me middle. So all of a sudden you have a snowball or avalanche of guys not trusting each other. So to me, when you go up 14 points in that short a span, it to me it feels like that you don't trust each other, you don't trust what's going on, and there's some dissension because of that.
Why is this team worse than they were a year ago?
Well, I disagree with Kenny. Every team has to have a guy.
And who's the guy on Detroit?
On offense.
Every team had your best player. He's the guy. Everybody follow his lead, whether that's good or bad. To me, the best player on Detroit is Andre Drummond. He, to me, is a stud. He's in a conversation every year with All-Star. I think the biggest problem with the Pistons is they think they got a lot of guys who think they're better than they are. That's what I think their problem is. You know, they got guys who got money, and people are like, whoa, I make money. I'm a star. I'm a good player. Instead of earning that respect, like I tell you, the guy I love in the NBA this year is DeMar DeRozan. Gets that big money. He comes out like, I'm taking my game to the next level. Actually, and this ain't an old guy hating on young guys. When I look at the Eastern Conference, there's so many underachieving teams. I think what's happening in the NBA is now everybody's making so much money, Ernie, now. There's no need to want to be great anymore. Like, I think mediocre players are making $10, $15 million. You're like, why am I going to kill myself?
Where's the incentive?
What's the incentive to go take my game to the next level? I do think there's so much money in the NBA, it's had a negative effect on the bad players. The great players always want to be great. But I think some of the mediocre players in the NBA are making so much money now, there's no need to be great.
Boston's second in the East. Are they the second best team behind Cleveland?
I would say, yeah. You know, they're playing very well. I still think they need one more big name guy. But, you know, Isaiah's doing all he can, and, you know, they play together. You know, Kenny talked about trust. They definitely trust each other on defense and on offense. And this guy, ever since his groin injury, averaging 32, playing lots of basketball. But I say this all the time. I wish he was 6'6".
If he was 6'6", he might average 50.
That's what I'm saying.
Or he might average 12. I mean, I think his size makes him want to have a chip on his shoulder. He was a late draft pick. I think he was the last guy picked. In the second round. I mean, well, that's only two rounds. And I think ever since then, we had him in Phoenix. I watched him in Sacramento. I think his size has actually, that has helped my point, Ernie. To be a great player, you have to have an attitude to want to be great. This guy wants to be great. He's what's great about the NBA.
Would you make a move for Melo if you were Boston?
Boston?
Yeah.
No. I don't know if he changes that makes them a championship team. I don't know if he gets them better than Cleveland. But, you know, they have a different style of play that he would probably have to kind of change his game and piece to. I just don't know if he makes them better. But It is a possibility. To me, he's an unbelievable scorer. And at this stage of his career, you know, they have to put guys who aren't the main guy on him. So all of a sudden, he still can be a great scorer.
Okay, if you were your buddy Danny Ainge, would you try to do something here to improve this team at the trade deadline?
Yes, but I would. Because you piggyback, I don't know if they're the second-best team in the Eastern Conference. Toronto and the Wizards are in that conversation. And I think they're close enough to being right there with, if they got the right piece, I think they could.
Is it Melo?
I do not think it's Melo, because I don't think Isaiah and Melo would mesh together because they both need the ball. And, you know, you said Isaiah, they don't mention him when they play defense. Well, they'd have two guys when they don't have the ball who wouldn't play defense. So I would make a move because you're stagnant. You're in the conversation as the second best team in the Eastern Conference, but you could lose to Toronto or the Wizards. But they got so many valuable pieces, and I think they got some good draft pick. I would make the move, to be honest with you.
Who would you go after?
You have to look at his contract, and, you know, you probably have to have a conversation with him. But, you know, Chuck makes an interesting point. Two guys that like to dribble the ball a lot, like to score, might not work. But, you know, if Carmelo were to come there and say, hey, you guys are already good, I just want to do what I can do, and if he sacrifices, you know, I think
it would look like, honestly, when he was in Denver, like Allen Iverson and him. I don't know if that really was a team that was a great championship mix. Right now, because everyone else is kind of what I call tossbacks. When they get the ball, the ball just keeps ping-ponging around. He's the only one that kind of creates off the dribble is Isaiah. And I think that's why it's worked so well for them.
But also, Ernie, the biggest problem is going to be the salaries.
Right.
They're going to have to give up so many players to match Carmelo's salary. I mean, I think Carmelo makes about $25 million a year. I don't think, other than Al Horford, I don't think anybody on the Celtics makes a lot of money.
And you have to get him to waive that no trade clause also in New York. Detroit number 10 in the East, Celtics number 2. It's game 1 of our double dip here on TNT.